They're not interested in this gospel thing. In fact, Jesus said it another way later. He said, don't take your pearls and put them before pigs. Some people like being dead. They love the dead life. We are to be people who love life. In fact, Jesus says, I'm going to give you life and give it to you abundantly. What does that mean? Well, it must mean something different than that dead life we used to have. And it's probably, again, eternally focused, and it's probably people focused. So, those who want to stay dead must be left to bury their dead. But we who want to stay with Him are those who love life and must work toward life in the lives of others. Third one. Matthew 16:24, he says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Again, the invitation. Jesus lived the life of a sacrificial servant. His people have to live the same kind of life. That's his expectation. It's not a life about creature comforts. It's about God and others. Philippians 2 is a great chapter in the Bible. It says, Jesus, the picture it paints is though he was one day sitting next to his Father, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the creator and sustainer of the universe. One day these two decide, it's not working down there. We need somebody to go down there and change everything, to reveal who I really am. And so Jesus gets up. It says, although he was God, he denied equality with God as something to maintain, to keep grasped, to hold on to. Instead, he denied that and became in the form of a man and a servant. Again, that Christmas story we just celebrated a few months ago is an amazing story. Is that how you would come if you were God as a baby? Most of us want fanfare and recognition. I want a medal when I do something good. I want recognition. To come in an obscure village as a baby, how vulnerable is that? Our God is incredibly humble. That's an amazing way for him to make entrance into the world and to entrust himself to a couple of folks for a period of time until he can defend himself. That's amazing. I think that's crazy. That's not how most of us would do it, I don't think. But that's how God did it. God's all about humility and denial and selflessness. Well, Paul, he is in there as well. He says in chapter, that same Philippians 2, the verse 3, he says, don't consider yourselves equal to others, but consider others better than yourselves. That's a tough one. And that's not how we normally roll. If I do that, then what happens? You'll step on me, right? I got to defend myself. That's not God's way. That's not his way. That's our flesh's way. Inwardly, when he says, deny yourself and take up your cross, the first part is an inward. It's an inward denial. All that stuff that creeps up in me and says, I must assert myself. I have to push back down. We have to deny ourselves. No, this isn't the time where I get to be first. The taking up the cross is the physical, the outward way I manifest that inward denial. That's what the Lord Jesus did. It's a twofold work. We deny ourselves and we take up the cross. The first requires a negative response to that which rises up in me. Cut me off from the road and I got all this stuff coming up in me. And now wants to manifest itself by cutting you off or giving you the you're number one sign. And all kinds of things that I want to do when you cut me off. Deny, take up the cross. If you're that big of a hurry, you can have my place. We're called to have a positive response to the will of God. That's what taking up our cross is. Remember how the Lord Jesus dealt with this thing. Look, this thing isn't an easy thing. The night that he was to, before he was to take up his cross, what does he do? He goes and he prays intense prayer. The chapters leading up that say many times he was in anguish. He was anxious. He was it was grievous to him to think about this cross. And so he gets on his face and he says to his father, look, is there a plan B here? Let's rethink this for a minute. But he ends with what? Not my will, but your will be done. If there's a way this cup can pass, if we can get another way to do this thing, let's do it now. It's okay to have that wrestling in our life. This isn't easy stuff. When we think this Christian call to follow him is an easy road, then we're not on the road, let me suggest. In fact, using the road analogy, Jesus one time said, the way is broad and easy is the road that leads to death. But the way is narrow and difficult is the path that leads to life. And few are those who are on it. That's, again, an amazing statement. It's an amazing statement when 90% of our country says they're Christians. 3 billion people in the world say they're Christians, but he says there's a narrow road, a difficult path, and few are on it. Maybe this thing is more than a mental assent to certain ideology. Maybe God's after something more. Well, self is our greatest enemy, but it's our constant companion. That's why we have to deny ourselves. Devils may be cast out, but not the flesh. It stays with us. It's interesting, when the story ends, God is going to do what with our bodies? These bodies don't get into heaven. That's not how the book's written. It says we get a new body, just like a new earth. It's amazing. This stuff doesn't get saved. This stuff doesn't get redeemed. He didn't die on the cross to make this better. It goes away. He has to make it new. It's too corrupted. The DNA is messed up. The spirit and the soul will go. That's amazing stuff. It's a hard word. The hardest thing to do is to deny ourselves and to take up the cross. It's the hardest thing the Lord Jesus did. Well, finally, Matthew 4, 19 to 21. He says, if you want to be perfect, go and sell your possessions and give the money to the poor. Then you'll have treasure in heaven and follow me. Well, that's an interesting story. Some of you know that as the rich young ruler story. But it's a great story because this guy comes up to Jesus and he says, good teacher, what do I have to do to get into heaven? And Jesus' first statement is, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. Jesus separates himself from this guy's perception of goodness. He doesn't identify with it. No one's good but God alone. Then he says, you know the commands, and he lists the bottom five of the Ten Commandments. And the guy says, I've done all those. And in the Luke version of this story, Jesus says, and he looked at him, and he loved him. And then he says, one thing you still lack. Go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and then follow me. Well, why does Jesus disassociate himself with being good? I think in part because this guy's idea of how to get to heaven was by being good. And that's, a lot of people have that view. That's not why Jesus died on the cross. Not for the bad guys to get to heaven, but for all of us to get into heaven. If any of us were good enough to get there, we don't need him to die on the cross. That's craziness. God's opinion of us is, hey, none of you good enough. All of us need a Savior. So did that guy. Our problem is, when we think about being rich, we don't compare ourselves with 3/4 of the world. We compare ourselves with Bill Gates. Right? And I'm poor. I got nothing. But that's not true. We're extremely wealthy. We should be very concerned about that. We're some of the only people in the universe that eat 3 meals a day and are going to go home to a warm house tonight and be dry all day, unless we stand in the rain too long. That's not a put-down, as some of our socialist friends might think about this country. That's the greatness of the nation. But at the same time, we're not like most of the world.